there's something about that name.
Thank you, BC. Now we have a special from Maya.
Thank you for that. I appreciate it very much, Maya. Let me get this clipped on here. Maybe you hear me a little better. Philippians, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. It feels better to be here than it does out in the Joy Center, though I appreciate the Joy Center quite a bit. On it, but it just feels more like worship, and I've heard others say that as well. We do welcome you here and hope the Lord blesses you in special ways. This message is it's going to lean a little bit of political. We're aiming toward November, so it's going to be political in a certain sense, but it's going to be biblical. And I'm not going to endorse any candidate or anything like that. If you want to know how I vote, just ask me. I won't hem-haw around. I'll tell you who I'm going to vote for. But the idea of Philippians is the getting along when you can't get along. Getting along when you can't get along. It's difficult, even in the world, in the spiritual world. There's Satanic and Satan and all of his demons and all of his philosophies and beliefs and what he believed and how he believed heaven should have been run or should be run. Part of it was that he should have had a voice when God was said, no, you're not going to have a voice, you're not have any part in heaven. But how do you get along when you can't get along? Lord God had problems in heaven with Satan and some of his angels, and even his angels, or certain angels, disagreed with God and what he is. So I don't think we should be any exceptions to that. We're going to have disagreement. But how you get along when you can't get along, and we'll look in Philippians. It's not a negative message, it's a positive one. Two important ideas here in Philippians. Number one, that the Lord is near, meaning that the Lord can hear and see what you're doing all the time. And he'll say that a little bit later in, when we read it in verse 5. And another thing in Isaiah, I wanted to bring it in, and it's the idea that the Lord is coming and his reward is with him. Well, it's very apparent there weren't very many rewards handed out when he walked this earth. And in the prophecy of Isaiah, it's really not talking about when he walked earth, but that prophecy does include that the Son of Man was coming, but that his reward with him, but it was the second coming that they're talking about, and that he's going to give rewards. And we're going to get the idea, with a reward, there's always conditions associated with it. I mean, everybody might get an award, but there's always a winner. Teachers or schools or organizations oftentimes give little mementos or little rewards to everybody on the team. But still, there's always a special player. There's a star, if you will. There's a requirement to being first or being foremost. With the Lord, one of the things that is handed out is the emphasis if you are faithful. That's the main thing that he highlights. In the book of Revelation, that's one of the things about the saints. Who are these? They are the faithful. Being faithful to the Lord is very important, but what does that mean? How does that draw on from the scriptures about being faithful, especially when you're trying to get along when you can't get along? I know it had been said that, and they said about our president that he is the most decisive president. He has divided more of our country than any other time. I say that's a great thing because Christians need to be taking a stand. You're either for Jesus or you're against Jesus. You're either standing for the principles that God has laid down in the Bible or you're against the principles that's laid down in the Bible. The Lord is at hand and his reward with him. He's not going to give rewards to everybody, only the faithful. Faithful to what? Faithful to his principles. Faithful to his morals. Faithful to what he believes ethically and spiritually is correct in the world that we live in. That's very important to realize. You can be faithful, and what does the word include? Depends on the circumstances. Spiritually, when we're talking about being faithful to the Lord, it means being faithful to what he believes. We are his children. We are followers of him. Your opinion might matter, but it doesn't matter as much as his matters. And if there's two opinions about something, most likely one is wrong, or at least both may be wrong, but the Lord's opinion is right. His is always right. And if you line up with the scriptures, if you line up with the principles and the ethics and the morals that the Bible lays down, you are always right. And when he comes back, he's going to give you a reward because you're faithful to his word. Now, that's all that's required. So, in essence, he does give a massive amount of rewards. The negative thing that follows that, if a Christian is not faithful in following the word of God, their rewards are going to be removed from them and given to the others that are faithful. That's highlighted in the parable of the talents. Taking things or rewards away from one that was not faithful and giving it to the faithful. So you might be the one individual that says, you know, I don't do a whole lot for the Lord. I stand up for him. I tell people I'm a Christian and I abide by the word of God. I'm faithful to the Bible. And if you do that, God considers you well done. You're faithful servant. Now, see, faithful is throughout the scriptures. Being faithful, he's going to take the rewards away from the unfaithful Christians and give it to you. That should be exciting. You're going to be blessed beyond measure just by being faithful to what God says and standing up for what he says. Look in chapter 4 of Philippians. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. So he begins that idea of standing fast, being faithful. What I've taught you before, stand faithful to that. Don't waver. Don't compromise what the Word of God says. I beseech Euodias and I beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. The key verse there is in the Lord. Now, you might say Euodias and Syntyche had a problem, had a difficulty, and we'll see that a little bit later. But verse 3 says, and I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow. Help these women which labor with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with others, my fellow laborers, whose names are written in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. The Lord is at hand. The Lord is near, is what it's saying. The Lord is close enough where he can see and know what you're doing. And you know, we have an isolation booth usually, or a secret ballot that we usually vote on, but that's not secret to the Lord. When it says the Lord is near, he knows how you vote. When the Lord is near and you're in a little booth, that's something we do this year. If you're there and you mark that, you think, no one can see me. The Lord is seeing you. And what he's balancing is if you are faithful to his word when you vote. Are you faithful to his word, to his principles, to his morals and his ethics? Do you support politicians or candidates that support or come close to what the Bible says is right in justice. It says here, again, I say rejoice. The Lord is at hand. The Lord is near you. The Lord is watching you. The Lord is seeing what you're doing. And that is what's important, because if the Lord is to return, what's important is that we're doing. If the Lord walks in and sees what we're doing, we need to be found faithful, the Bible teaches. Let your moderation be known unto all man. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. How do you know, or how do you get along despite your differences? We'll see a little bit about this. These two ladies seem to be having difficulty. Doesn't say in Scripture what the difference was. We have no idea, other than Paul thought that they ought to line up with Scripture. They ought to line up with what the Lord believes. You have controversy with somebody, and what they're doing is not lining up with the Scriptures. This is what God upholds. This is what God says. This is what God's Word says. If you stand on that and His principles, you are in the right, the Scripture says, and you are faithful. There are many differences that we cannot avoid, it seems like. Theological differences. When you look into the Bible, there's always going to be some theological debate going on. Even among great scholars today, they debate theological differences. It boils down to being faithful to the moral ethics and principles of the Bible. They might argue about angels, they might argue about concepts, but there's no argument when you pull out the Scripture about how morally and ethically and how you should act in a world that we live in. That's pretty plain written in Scriptures. The idea of different versions of the Bible theologically might come up. Some like King James Version, some like more modern translations. The idea is, can you get the principles, morals, and ethics of the Lord out of whatever version you're reading? Do you live a holy and righteous life? Are you faithful to the Lord and what He says? That's what matters that you get out of the version that you have. Different sins individuals have to overcome. So certain scriptures are more favorable to them, and there may be their lifestyle. The idea last Sunday about clothing yourself with what the Lord desires for you to clothe, but you have to take off something. Take pride, for instance. There's good pride and bad pride. There's good in it being proud, but also the idea of humility. So you have to take off your pride and you have to put on some humility, spiritual clothes, theological difference in one's life. It's often sensitive, too, when you talk about differences, especially when it concerns certain high emotions in individuals' life. Family draws a high emotion and sensitive subjects to individuals. Close friends, when they weep and cry with them about the problems they may be having. And also things about the pet sins that individuals try to protect. And you'll find out this is some of the differences that you're going to encounter in individuals' life. They want to continue the sins that they are sinning. So they try to justify it in some way, morally and ethically, and they deviate from the Bible, or they pull away from the Bible, and they use logic and try to look into people's experiences and use man's wisdom in order to accomplish that. But when you pull it back to the Bible, sin is still sin and causes damage in individuals' life. Verse 2, it talks about beseeching. Paul is saying to yield to his advice. I'm calling to you, listen to what I'm saying. That's what the Lord says. Whenever you check a mark on a ballot, whenever you support a candidate, whether it's financially, prayerfully, however you do it, They need to line up with what the Bible says. That's being faithful to the Word of God. In this world we live in, that is what you're called to do, is to be faithful to the Word of God, its principles, its morals, its ethics. Paul's advice depended on how much they believe. Paul's advice was from Jesus. There are theologians out there that discard Apostle Paul as a womanizer, as an individual that didn't like women, and they have several other excuses about Apostle Paul. But in essence, the Apostle Paul was a messenger of God. He laid down morals and ethics and conduct an individual should follow, but not all believed what he said. Following Paul's advice depended on what sins prevented an individual from trusting what Jesus wanted them to do. People have pet sins. They have into things that they want to continue and they hide it, and yet they try to justify it. The Lord knows my circumstances. Morals, ethics, principles, the Lord only understands His. He's a jealous God. He comes down with wrath. Hell is eternal. That's pretty powerful. That's a pretty powerful voice when you're talking about a worm that do never die and fire that is never quenched. That is a powerful voice on the idea that God does not compromise some things. Advice requires wisdom from the Lord, James says. And Paul was beseeching these ladies, please seek the Lord. Please listen to what I'm saying. Come together in unity and find out what the Lord would have you to do. It might require both individuals to give up something. Might require just one individual to swallow its pride or her pride and admit, no, you're right, Eodius, I was wrong. It takes the humility to do that. But it takes trusting in the Lord, that the Lord is right in what He says. And when you look into the Scriptures, Paul is saying, trust in the Lord in what He says. The differences. Paul's goal was unity. Wasn't a personal opinion. It was what he knew what the Lord wanted. Fighting a spiritual war, unity is so important. Winning a battle is so important, especially when unity is involved. Unity may require changing your attitude, may require changing your belief, may require changing your party affiliation even, in sense. If it does not line up with what God's Word says, the Lord does not want a Christian to follow that individual. Now, that's not my words. That's the idea of faithfulness to the Word of God. Faithfulness to Jesus is that, and it's lined up that way all through Scripture. He was pleased with individuals and displeased with many. Why? They were not faithful to His Word and what He said. First politician, you might say, in the Bible was Nimrod. The Tower of Babel, the tower, we call it Tower of Babel, where the language was divided, where God interacted or God came down and studying about the Tower of Babel and Nimrod, he faced God in the sense that he was in opposition to what God, the popular idea of what God's Word was in that day. Built him a tower. He was a great hunter, the Bible said. You could study a little bit about Nimrod and read about him, but he was the first politician that went wrong against the Lord, and God intervened. The faithful were the ones that were rewarded, and the ones that were not faithful were not rewarded. Biblical issues you see here, which involves morals and ethics in an individual life. One of the issues is the two citizens in the Word of God. When we look about it, it shouldn't matter what the what Time magazine says. It shouldn't matter what the Bible says about abortion. The United States is not a theocracy. And this is true in a sense. The statement is true. It's not a theocracy, but yet we are a citizen of the kingdom of God. We know the Lord. So we are citizens of the kingdom. And what matters more than anything is to believe what the Lord says as citizens. That's who we follow first. Verse 2 says, the same mind in the Lord. We follow the Lord in His concepts. Political issues can become idol worship for individuals. Matthew says, tell us, is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. Citizens of the heavenly kingdom or the kingdom of God, tribute, support, allegiance. There are certain things we should give to our government, but certain things we should not give in that sense. The Bible is a proof of that. Idea of embracing what the Lord desires for us to do, praying and seeking what He says. 2 Peter says, they have gone off the road and become lost like Balaam, the son of Beor, who fell in love with money he could make by doing wrong. Making money, embracing the wrong because of finance. We may have sacrificed some finance in order to go what's right and what the Lord desires for you to do in any political circumstance or situation. Judas is another example, not only Balaam and the donkey, but Judas Iscariot. What about the 30 pieces of silver that he sold, in a sense, Jesus for? Money is a big issue. It's vital for our well-being in the world we live in. We may be called on sacrifice some finances because of standing for what the Lord desires for us. How else are you going to be tested faithful? How else are you going to be challenged unless you are challenged with something that you have to sacrifice in your life? I may want this, I desire this, but I know the Lord is not in that. I know the Lord doesn't want that for me, so I'm going to stick with what the Lord says. Verse 3 talks about the church taking sides in that sense. Look at verse 3. I entreat thee also true yoke fellow, help these women which labor with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are written in the book of life, faithful. These are Christians. We're not talking about individuals who are not Christians, but we're talking about Christians that have lost their way, Christians that are siding not with the principles and the ethics and morals of the Bible. That's dangerous. You could lose your rewards, all the rewards that you've worked for all of your life. You come to the end of your life, and what you're doing is supporting the wrong individual, and you lose your rewards. God takes those out according to the parable of the talents and gives it to somebody that has been faithful. Being faithful to what? To God's Word. That's what it boils down to in that sense. Church is very precious to Jesus. It's His conduit to the world of sinners outside the church. The voice that Christ wants to say, I love you and I care for you and I want you to come in and I want to be your Lord and your Savior. What does the Lord mean? It means that I tell you what to do. The Lord does. And that's very important. Help these women, he says here, Paul does. Help these women about their controversy. I just wonder if anybody wanted to get between these two women. Why did Paul need to write a letter and mention that in here? Now, I don't know who these women were, but they may have been outstanding Christians in the church. I don't think anybody wanted to get in between them. We've got deacons here, and if I questioned them, whoa, it'd be like me. I don't want to get involved between two women catfighting. But it was in the Lord. Come together in the Lord. Discuss it about what the Bible says. You can't compromise what the Word of God says. You just can't as a faithful servant of the Lord. And when you have a candidate out there, when you have an individual out there, you need to be looking at what they believe in and what they say, because that is going to be whether the Lord judges you as faithful to His Word and His principles. They say 2020 is a monumental or a pivotal point in America's history. I don't know if it will be or not. They might say that about the next election. But what we need to do as Christians is to be faithful to what the Lord wants, not what you want, not your opinion, not your ideas, but the ethics and morals in the Bible. You compare that with a candidate, and you do not vote for anybody that is contrary to what that is. I get things through the mail all the time, and I got something here, and one of the things that says here, it says, one candidate says abortion on demand, and it said yes, and the other candidate said no. The Bible says no to abortion on demand. And the candidate, if it upholds that, they are violating in scriptures, and you risk the risk of losing your rewards because you are not faithful to the Lord. This is Bible, folks. This is not something contrary to what we're saying. I'm not endorsing any candidate. I'm endorsing what the Word of God's saying. Look at what the Bible says and hold that up as a mirror to the individuals. Paul said, true yoke fellow, be a peacemaker. And yet the idea of peacemaker, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God, peacemakers. This skill was so important to the apostles and the early disciples in the early church. Matthew talked about the children of God as if it were a title to the true disciples of Jesus Christ. Does this mean you have to be meek, mild, silent, and not cause a fuss or stand what is right biblically? If you stand biblically, you're going to cause a fuss. If you stand for what's right, you're going to cause dissension. It's not talking about that. Matthew says this, Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. I wouldn't say that was meek and mild out of Jesus. He carried the principles of his Father, the morals and ethics, and they were violating it. And he went in and turned over the tables and ran them out of the temple. Now, I don't advocate you doing that in a riot or anything, but I'm just making an emphasis that you can stand for what is right. And the Word later on talks about that. Isaiah says, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. A warning from Isaiah. Warning from God, stand for what is right. And make your convictions trust in what the Lord is saying. Look in verse 5, let your moderation be known unto all men. So it does say broadcast what you believe. It does say stand for what you believe in. It does say that people should know what you trust and who you trust in and whom you trust in. The definition of moderation in verse 5, not insisting on every right of letter of law or custom, yielding gently, kind, courteous, and tolerant. These are all words for the idea of moderation, being moderate. Not pitching a fit, not cussing, not causing a riot, but just saying, I stand on the Word of God, and this candidate lines up for that. This is what this candidate believes, and this is what the Bible says, principles, the morals, the ethics, and they line up with this. There are some things that the Lord considers very valuable to himself, so be cautious about that. There are some things in the Bible, when you violate that, he considers you not faithful in what you're doing. Here's what it says in the Message in Philippians, another word for moderation. Make it as clear as you can to all who you meet that you're on their side, working with them and not against them. Help them see that the Master is about to arrive. He could show up any minute. What would the Lord, and when he is near, when he's looking at you, what does he say, and how does he say you line up with the principles and conduct of the Word of God? I stand for what Jesus stands for. And whatever that is out there, I'm a citizen of the kingdom of God. I have to uphold that citizenship, and even though I am an American as well, moderation. here in God's Word translation, it says, let everyone know how considerate you are and what you stand for. These two women couldn't stop thinking about it. They talked about it. They discussed it. In verse 6 says, be careful. Be careful for nothing, it says here. Worry. It'll stall your life and dominate your thinking. And that's what this phrase highlights. Be careful for nothing. Watch what you're worrying about that it doesn't cause such a bog in your spiritual life that your faith will waver. Be faithful to the Lord and to the Word of God, he's saying here. The Open Bible Commentary says this, prayer sets a Christian to thinking in one direction with one purpose or with a purpose. How do you get along when you can't get along? There are a lot of exceptions to the rule, and I know it is. When you're looking for the good God has created and the world that we live in, that might be considered an exception. God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. The environment, the world we live in, the air we breathe, the water we drink, it's very important. And it's important to God, too, and it should be important to us. Being careful, being worried, and maybe we need to worry more about the environment. But he said it was very good, what he created. What about trying to help family? Jesus was worried about his family. We need to worry about our family as well. Here in John it says, then saith he to the disciples, behold thy mother. And from that hour that disciple took her into his own home. He worried about his mother. Why was he going to do that? He was going to heaven. He could. What did he need to tell his John that, John, take care of my mother. I won't be here any longer. Because he worried about his mother, didn't he? He worried about his family. So the idea is we should worry about our families. And there may be other rules and other exceptions, you might say. Verse 6 talks about several conclusions about what Paul was saying here about being faithful to God's word in a political world that we live in. Notice what he says, verse 6. He talks about prayer. Getting the Holy Spirit involved in your worrying process is very important. And another thing he talks about, being specific, supplication, he says. Being specific about what you're praying for, relying on the Holy Spirit, may not know what to pray for in the future. Romans says this, likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities, our problems, our worries, our difficulties. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. We groan, we moan, and cry unto the Lord. And we should be doing more of that, Apostle Paul says. When you can't get along, or trying to get along when you can't get along, he says, try supplication in that sense with the Holy Spirit. Thanksgiving is another thing that Apostle Paul mentions. Accepting the spiritual outcome. If you're done all that you can do and you've prayed all you can pray, you try to adjust with whatever the outcome is. It may not be what we want and what we desire. Romans says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Now, Romans was saying, you can't live peaceably with all people. Why? Because they're not going to live like you want to live. They're not going to understand what God's word says. They're not want to live ethically and moral life, nor with the principles that the Bible lays down. They won't want that. And when you live like that, there's going to be controversy in your life. And Paul says, as much as possible, try to live peaceably with all men. The next thing Paul lists is the idea of honesty. Let the true request be made known to God, not what you're dictating to him. Lord, this is what I believe. You're opening your heart and saying, Lord, what is it that you would teach me? What is it that I need to learn from this experience or from this? What does the Spirit need to, how do, are you talking to me when you're reading your devotion or reading the Bible? And have the Lord spiritually speaking to you in that sense. Paul reminded the Philippians the impact and importance of the main person and the main issue involved, the one that was coming. The Lord is at hand. Isaiah says that he is coming with his reward. Now, if you've worked hard for that thing, you don't want to give it up because you're not faithful. How can I measure if I'm faithful? Do you line up with what the Bible says morally, ethically, and principally in what it lays down? The Lord is coming back one day. If he doesn't come back and we die and we go to him, the same principles will be in heaven. He's going to hand out rewards. There's going to be unfaithful Christians over here. Jude says there are. And these unfaithful Christians are going to lose all of their rewards. And who's going to get them? You will. The faithful ones will be there. The idea of compromise, the idea of turning away from the Lord is in the world, and we're facing it today, every day. But what Jesus would encourage you to do is to not be angry with a lot of individuals, but stand up for what is right and what is holy. Be holy, for he is holy. If somebody wants to know what you believe and what you stand for, and what a candidate or what politician or what individual you might support, share that with them and include some scripture with that, because this is what the Lord desires from us. He desires that type of unity in the Christians that we love and care for. But you're not going to be able to get along with all of them, but the ones you can, encourage them. The ones you can't, pray for them in that sense. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we do love you, and thank you for the government and all of the turmoil and conflict that we see out there. Thank you that we can sort through it by staying true to your light, to your principles. For you are a light unto our feet, and you lead us in the paths of righteousness. And it's all for your name's sake. And we praise you for it. May you continue to be with us. May we be found faithful, voting, encouraging, voicing, stressing to individuals the importance it is to have individuals in government that believe as Christians should believe. And Lord, we do trust in you. Whatever you decide, we believe in you. And we ask that you might encourage us and strengthen us in the things that we do not understand. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we sing what number?
428.
428.